spot too.
Aeschylus.
My lord.
Of government, the properties to unfold would seem in me to affect speech and discourse, since I am put to know that your own science far exceeds in that all the list of advice my strength can give you. Here is thy commission, from which we would not have thee warned. Know we have with special soul elected him our absence to supply, lent him our terror, dressed him in our love, and given his deputation all the organs of our own power. But what think you?
If any in Vienna feels worth to undergo such ample grace and honor, it is Lord Angelo.
Ah, look when he comes. Always obedient to your grace's will, I come to know your pleasure. Hold therefore, Angelo. In our remove, be thou fully at our side. Mortality and mercy in Vienna lie in thy heart and tongue. Lady Aeschylus, though first in question, shall be thy secondary. Here is your commission. Now, my good lord, let some more test be made of my mettle before so noble and so great a figure be stamped upon it. Enough evasion. We have with leavened and prepared thought therefore take your honors. Our hasten hence is such that it prefers itself and leaves an answered matter of needful value. Therefore farewell. For the hopeful execution do I leave you with my commission. Yet do we need, my lord, that we may bring you something on the way. Our haste may not prefer it, nor need you upon mine honor have to do with any scruple. Thy scope is as mine own, so to enforce or qualify the law as your soul seeks. I'll privately away. I do love the people, but do not love to stage me to their eyes. Though it do well, I do not relish well their loud applause and abbey's vehement, nor do I think the man of sound discretion that does affect it. Fare you well. May heaven keep safe your girls.
Lead forth and bring you back in
happiness. I thank you. Once more, farewell. Satisfaction have touching that point.
I will wait upon your honor.
No, but there's a woman with me by him. You haven't heard the proclamation, have you?
What proclamation, man?
All I was is in the suburbs of Vienna to be plucked to the ground.
What shall become of those in the city?
They shall stand for siege. They would have gone too, but that a wise old burgher put in for them.
Shall all our houses of resort in the suburbs be pulled down?
To the ground, mistress.
Why, here's a change indeed in the Commonwealth. But what shall become of me?
Fear not you. Good counsellors lack no clients. Though you'll change your place, you need not change your trade. I'll be a taxer still. Courage! There will be pity taken on you. You have given your eyes out almost in the service. You will be considered.
What's to do here, Thomas Tapster? Let's withdraw.
Claudio led to prison by the provost.
Fellow, why dost thou show me thus to the world? Bear me to prison where I am committed.
I do it not in evil disposition, but from Lord Angelo by special charge.
Thus can the demigod authority make us pay down for our offence by weight. Heaven's words, on whom it will, it will. On whom it will not, so, yet still 'tis just.
How now, Claudio?
Whence comes this restraint?
From too much liberty, my dear Lucio, liberty.
What's thy offence?
What but to speak of would offend again?
It's murder?
No.
Letry.
Call it so.
Away, sir, you must go!
One word, good friend. Lucio, a word with you.
100 if they'll do any good.
Is Letry so good?
Thus stands it with me. Upon a true contract, I got possession of Julietta's bed. You know the lady, she is fast my wife, save that we do the denunciation lack of outward order. This we came not to, only for propagation of a dower, remaining in the coffer of her friends, from whom we thought it meet to hide our love, till time had made them for us. But it chances that the stealth of our most mutual entertainment, with character too gross, is writ on Juliet.
With child, perhaps.
Unhappily, even so, and the new deputy now for the Duke, whether it be the faltering glimpse of newness, or whether the body public be a horse whereon this governor doth ride, who, newly in his seat, lets it know he can command, and lets me straight fill the spur. Whether the tyranny be in his place, or in the eminence that fills it up, I stagger in. But this new governor invokes on me all the enrolled penalties, which have like unscoured armour hung by the wall so long that 19 zodiacs have gone round, and none of them been worn. And for a name, now puts this drowsy and neglected act freshly upon me. 'Tis surely for a name.
No, I warrant it is.
Send up the Duke and appeal to him.
I have done so, but he's not to be found. I prithee, Lucio, do me this kind service. This day my sister should the cloister enter, there to receive her approbation, acquaint her with the danger of my state, implore her in my voice that she make friends with this strict deputy, bid herself assay him. I have great hope in that, for in her youth there is prone and speechless dialect such as movement, and well she can persuade.
I pray she may. I would be sorry should you thus foolishly lose the game of tic-tac. How to her?
Thanks, good friend Lucia.
Within 2 hours!
Here's a complete bosom. Now, why I desire thee to give me secret harbour hath a reason more grave and wrinkled than the aims and ends of burning youth.
May your grace speak of it?
We have given to Lord Angelo, a man of stricture and firm abstinence, our absolute power and place in Vienna. And he supposes me travelled to Poland, for so we have strewed it in the common ear, and so it is received.
Now, pious sir,
you'll ask me why I do this.
Gladly, my lord.
We have strict statutes and most biting laws, the needful bits and curbs to headstrong weeds, which we, for these 14 years, have let slip. For terror not to use becomes more mocked than feared. and thus our decrees, dead to infliction, are to themselves dead. Liberty plucks justice by the nose. The baby beats the nurse, and fight athwart goes all the
country. It rested with your grace to unloose these tied-up laws when you pleased. But it, in you, more dreadful would seem than Lord Angelo.
I do fear too dreadful. Therefore we have on Lord Angelo imposed the office, who may, in the absence of my name, strike home, and my nature never incite to do it slander. And, to behold his sway, we shall, as 'twere one of your order, visit both prince and people. Therefore, I prithee, supply me with the habit, and teach me how I may, formally, in person, conduct me as a true friar. More reason for this will I convey at our more leisure. Only this. Lord Angelo is precise, stands aguard with envy, scarce admits his blood doth flow, or that his taste is more to bread than stone. Now hence shall we see if power change purpose.
Setting it up to fear the birds of prey,
and letting it keep one shape till it become their perch and not their terror.
Aye, but yet, let us be keen and rather cut a little than fall and bruise to death. Alas, this gentleman, whom I would save, had a most noble father. Let but your honour know, whom I believe to be most straight in virtue, that, in the working of your own affection, had time cohered with place, or place with wishing, or that the resolute acting of our blood could have attained the effect of our own purpose, whether you had not once in your life erred in this point, which now you censure him, and pulled the law upon you.
'Tis one thing to be tempted, Essex. 'Tis another thing to fall. I do not deny that the jury, passing on the prisoner's life, may in the sworn 12 have a thief or two guiltier than him they try. What's made open to justice, that justice seizes. What knows the laws that thieves do make upon thieves? You may not extenuate his offense, for I have had such faults. Rather tell me than censure him when I do so offend. Then let mine own judgment carry out my death, and let nothing come impartial. Sir, he must die.
Be it as your wisdom will.
See that Claudio be executed by tomorrow morning. Bring in his confessor. Let him be prepared, for that is the utmost of his pilgrimage.
Will heaven forgive him and forgive us all? Some rise by sin, and some by virtue falls. Some run from breaks of vice and answer none, and others condemn it for a fault alone.
Be good people in the commonweal. Abuse and abuses in common houses. I know no law. Come away.
How now, madam? What's your name? And what's the matter?
If it please your worship, I am the poor Duke's constable, and my name is Elbow. I do lean upon justice, sir, and I've been before your honour two notorious benefactors.
Benefactors? But what benefactors are they? Are they not malefactors?
Please, your honour, I know not what they are. They're two precise villains, they are, that I am sure of. And I do all proper nation in the world as good Christians ought to have.
Well, sir, what are you?
Sir? He's a tapster, sir. He's a parcel board. One that serves a bad woman whose house was, so they say, down in the suburbs. I do now profess it's a hot house, which I think is a very ill house too.
How know you that?
Why, mum, by my sister, whom I do detest above all others.
How, thy sister?
Why, mum, my sister is a very honest woman.
Dost thou detest her, therefore?
I say, mum, I detest myself as well as she. This house, if it be not a board's house, 'tis a naughty house.
Dost thou know that, constable?
Why, mum, my sister. For if she'd been a woman cardinally given, she might have been accused of fornication, adultery, and all uncleanliness there.
By woman's means?
Why, mum, by Mistress Overdone's means. But if she spit in his face, so she defied him.
If it please your honour, this is not so.
Oh, prove it before these varlets hear that honourable man. Prove it.
Do you hear how he misplaces?
She came in, great with child and longing, saving your honour's reverence, for still prunes. Having but two in the house, which at that very distant time stood, as it were, in a fruit dish, a dish of some 3 pence. Your honours have seen such dishes, not china dishes, but very good dishes indeed.
Oh, go to, no matter for the dish, sir.
No, indeed, ma'am. Not of a pin, you are therein in the right, but to the point. Now this Mistress Elbow, being with child and longing, as I say, for stewed prunes, having but two in the house, as I said, Master Frothy, this very man, having eaten all the rest, as I said, and as I say, paying for them very honestly. Well, you know, Master Frothy, I could not give you those 3 pence again.
No, indeed, sir.
Very well, you being remembered then, cracking the stones of the aforesaid prunes.
Aye,
sir. Very well, then. And you remember that such a one and such a one were past cures of the things you want to have.
You are a tedious fool. To the point. What what was done to Elmo's sister that she had cause to complain of. Come meet to what was done to her.
You shall come to the point, ma'am. I beseech you. Look at Master Frothia, a man of some 80 pounds a year, whose father died at Allomass. Was it Allomass, was it not, Master Froth?
All Allon Dee.
Hey, why, very well then. Here be truth. And he, ma'am, as I say, sitting in the lower chair, is indeed at the bunch of plates, where you happy like the sin of you not.
Hoist I do, for it is an open room and good for winter.
Very well then, I hope here be truth.
This could last out a night in Russia, when nights are longest there.
I'll leave you to the hearing of the cause, and hope you find cause to whip them all.
I think no less. Good morrow to your lordship. Come, sir. What was done to Elmo's sister once more?
There was nothing done to her once, ma'am.
Oh, I beseech you, ma'am, ask him what this man did to my sister.
I beseech you, ma'am, ask me.
Well, sir, what did this gentleman to her?
I beseech you, ma'am, look at the gentleman. Master Froth, look at her ladyship. It doth serve good purpose. Mark his face well, ma'am.
Aye, very well, sir.
I beseech you, ma'am, no, I beseech you, mark it well.
Well, I do so.
Right, very well. His face is the worst thing about it. Right then, if his face is the worst thing about him, how could he have done any harm to the constable's sister? I ask that of your honour.
He's in the right, constable. What say you to it?
First, mum, this is a respected house. Next, this is a respected woman.
By this,
my sister is a respected woman too.
By this hand, she's more respected than all of us here.
Oh, now, father, now. My sister has never been respected with man, woman or child.
She was more respected with him before he married with her.
Oh, which is the wiser here, justice or iniquity?
Is this true? Ma'am. Oh, thou
Caitiff.
This is a varlet. This is a caitiff. This is a wicked Hannibal. Please, ma'am, don't think me the poor Duke's officer. You wicked Hannibal, you. I shall have my action of battery upon me.
If he took you a box of the year, you'd have your action of slander, too.
Pray, ma'am, what is it your honour's pleasure I shall do with this wicked Kate?
Truly, officer, because he had some offences in him, which thou wouldst discover if thou couldst, let him continue in his courses until thou knowest what they are.
Mary, I thank your worship. You hear that? You are to continue. You are to continue.
Where were you born, friend?
In Vienna, ma'am.
Are you of 80 pounds a year?
Yes, and to like you, ma'am.
And, sir, what trade are you of?
Tapster, ma'am. Poor widow's tapster.
Your mistress's name?
Mistress Overdone.
And hath she had any more than one husband?
Oh, 9, ma'am. Overdone by the last.
9. Come hither to me, Master Frost. I would not have you acquainted with tapsters, Master Frost. They will draw you, and you will hang them. Now, get you gone, and let me hear no more of you.
Oh, thank you, ma'am. For my own part, I never go into any room in a tap house, but I am drawn in.
Well, no more of it, Master Frost. Fare you well. Come hither to me, Master Tapster. What is your name, Master Tapster?
Pompey, ma'am.
What else?
Bum, ma'am.
Frost, and your bum is the greatest thing about you, so that in the beastliest sense, you are Pompey the Great. Pompey, you are partly a bore, Pompey. Howsoever you colour it in being a tapster, are you not? Come, tell me true. It shall be the better for you.
Truly, ma'am, I'm a poor man who would live.
But how would you live, Pompey? By being a board? What think you to the trade, Pompey? Is it a lawful trade?
If the law would allow it, ma'am.
The law will not allow it. Nor it shall not be allowed in Vienna.
Does your honour intend to geld and splay all the youth in the city?
No, Pompey.
And in my poor opinion, ma'am, there'll be to it then. If your honour would take order for the drabs and knaves, then you need not fear the boards.
There are pretty orders beginning, I can tell you. It is but heading and hanging.
If you head and hang all who offend but for 10 years together, you'll be glad to give out commission for more heads. If this law holds for 10 years in Vienna, I'll rent out the fairest house in it after Thwuppence a Bay. If you live to see this come to pass, Pompey told you so.
Well, thank you, good Pompey. And, in requital of your courtesy, hark you, I advise you, let me not find you before me again upon any complaint whatsoever. No, not for dwelling where you do. If I do, Pompey, I shall beat you to your tent and prove a shrewd Caesar to you. In plain dealing, I shall have you whipped. So, for this time, Pompey, fare you well.
I thank you for your good counsel, ma'am. I shall follow it as flesh and fortune shall better determine. Whip me, no. Let the carter whip his jade. A valiant heart's not whipped out of his trade.
By the readiness in the office that you had continued in it for some time. You say 7 years together.
And a half, ma'am.
Alas, it hath great pains upon you. They do you wrong to put you so oft upon. Are there not gentlemen in your ward sufficient to serve it?
Fie, ma'am. There were none with any wits to do it. As they are chosen, they choose me to do it for them. And I do it for some piece of money.
Well, look you, bring me the names of some six or seven
to your worship's house?
To my house.
Right, and when, ma'am?
At 4 o'clock. What o'clock is it now, please?
11 o'clock, ma'am.
Oh, it grieves me for the death of Claudio, but there is no remedy.
Nay, ma'am. Lord Angelo, he is very severe, ma'am.
It is but needful. Mercy is not itself which oft looks so. Pardon is still the nurse of second woe.
Indeed.
But yet, poor Claudio. There is no remedy. Come, mistress.
Hearing of course, I'll tell the Marquis. He'll come straight.
Pray you do. I'll know his feelings. Maybe he will relent. Alas, he hath but as offended in a dream. All sex, all ages smack of this vice, and he to die for it.
Now what's the matter, promise?
Is it your will Claudio shall die tomorrow?
Didst I not tell thee, yea? Hadst thou not order, why dost thou ask again?
Lest I might be too rash under your good correction, I have seen when, after execution, judgment hath repented o'er his doom.
Go to, let that be my do your office, or give up your place.
I crave your honour's pardon. What should be done with the groaning Juliet? She is near her hour.
Dispose of her to some more fitting place, and do that with speed. Admitted. See you that the fornicatress be removed. Let her have needful but not lavish means. There shall be order for it.
Save your honour.
Stay you a little while. You are welcome. What's your will?
I am a woeful suitor to your honour. Please, but your honour hear me.
Well, what's your suit?
There is a vice that most I do abhor, and most desire should meet the blow of justice. For which I must not plead, but that I am at war twixt will and will not.
Well, the matter.
I have a brother is condemned to die. I beseech you, let it be his fault and not my brother.
Heaven give thee moving graces.
Condemn the fault and not the actor of it. Why, all faults would be condemned ere it were done. Mine would be the very cipher of a function, to find the fault whose fine stands on record, and let go by the actor.
Oh, just. I had a brother then. Heaven save your honour.
Now give it not her so.
You are too cold. To him again. Entreat him. Kneel down before him. Hang upon his gown. To him again, I say. You are too cold.
Oh, must he needs die?
Maiden, no remedy.
And yet I do think that you might pardon him, and neither heaven nor man grieve at the mercy.
I will not do it.
But can you if you would?
Look, what I will not, that I cannot do.
But might you do it, and to the world no wrong, if so your heart were touched with that remorse as mine is to him?
He's sentenced. 'Tis too late.
You are too cold.
Too late? Why, no, I that do speak a word may call it back again. Oh, believe this. No ceremony that a great one's long. Oh, not the king's crown or the deputed sword, the marshal's truncheon or the judge's robe become them with one half so good a grace. potency in you, Isabel. Should it then be thus? No, I would tell what to be a judge and what a prisoner.
I touch him, there's a bang.
Your brother is a forfeit of the law, and you but waste your words.
Alas, alas, why all the souls that were forfeit once, and he that might the vantage best have took found out the remedy. How would you be if he, which is the top of all judgment, should but judge you as you are? Oh, think on that, and mercy then will breathe within your lips like man new made.
Be content, fair maid. It is not I that condemns, but the law. Were he mine own kinsman, my brother, my son, 'twould be thus with him. He must die tomorrow.
Tomorrow? Oh, that's sudden. Oh, spare him, spare him. He's not prepared for death. Even for our kitchen we kill the fowl of season. Should we serve heaven then with less respect than we do minister to our gross self? Oh, good, good, my lord, bethink you. Who is it that hath died for this offence? There's many have committed it.
Aye, well said.
The law hath not been dead, yet it hath slept. Those many may not have done those evil deeds, if that the first of them that did this edict infringe had answered to his deed. Now 'tis awake, takes note of what is done, and like a prophet, looks in a glass to see what future evils, either now or by remissness new, and so in progress, to be hatched or born, are now to have no successive degrees, but ere they live to end.
Yet show some pity.
Show it most when I show justice, for then I pity him I do not know, which a dismissed offence might after gall, and do him right that answering one foul wrong lives on to act another. Be satisfied. Your brother dies tomorrow. Be content.
Sir, you must be the first that gives this sentence, and he that suffers. 'Tis excellent to have the strength of a giant, but it is tyrannous to use it like a giant.
That's well said.
Can great men thunder as Jove himself does? Jove would ne'er be quiet, for every petty, pelting officer could use his heaven for thunder, nothing but thunder. Oh, merciful heaven, thou rather with thy sharp and sulphurous bolt splits the unwedgeable and gnarled oak than the soft myrtle. But man, proud man, dressed in a little brief authority, most ignorant of what he is most assured, his glassy essence, like an angry ape, plays such fantastic tricks before high heaven as makes the angels weep, who with our spleens would all themselves laugh mortal.
To him, wench, he is coming, you will relent. I perceive it.
By heaven, she will him.
Why do you put these sayings upon me?
Because authority, though it err like others, hath yet a kind of medicine in itself that skins the vice o'er the top. Go to your bosom, knock there, and ask your heart what it doth know that's like my brother's fault. If it confess a natural guiltiness such as his, let it not sound a thought upon your tongue against my brother's life.
She speaks, and 'tis such sense that my sense breeds with it. Fare you well.
Oh, good my lord, turn back.
I will bethink me. Come again tomorrow.
Hark, how I'll bribe you, gentle my lord, turn back.
How? Bribe me.
I with such gifts as heaven shall share with you.
You had model else.
Not with the fond sickles of the tested gold, or stones whose rate is either rich or poor as fancy values them, but prayers of true saints that are up at heaven and shall enter there ere sunrise. Prayers from preserved souls, from fasting maids whose minds are dedicated to nothing temporal.
Well, come again tomorrow.
Heaven save your
honor. I'll go to swell away.
Amen. For I am that way going to temptation where prayers cross.
At what hour tomorrow shall I attend your lordship?
Any time for noon.
Heaven save your honor.
From thee. Even from thy virtue. What's this? What's this? Is this her fault or mine? The tempter or the tempted, who sins most, huh? 'Tis not she, nor does she tempt, but 'tis I, that lying with a violet in the sun, act as the carrion does, and not the flower, corrupt with virtuous season. Can it be that modesty may more betray the sense than women's likeness? Having waste ground enough, do we desire to raise the sanctuary and pitch our evils there? Oh, fie, 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 what dost thou? What art thou, Angela? desire her foully for the things that make her good. Let a brother live. Thieves for their robberies have authority when judges steal themselves. What? Dost thou love her, that thou dost wish to hear her speak again and feast upon her eyes? What is't thou dream of? Cunning enemy, that to catch a saint, with saints dost bait thy hook. Most dangerous is that temptation that goads us on to sin in loving virtue. Never could the strumpet, with her twin vigor, art and nature, once stir my temper. But this virtuous maid subdues me quite. Ever, when men were fond, I smiled and wondered.
Charity and my holy order, I come to visit the afflicted spirits here in prison. Do me the common right to let me see them, and let me know their crimes, that I may minister to them accordingly.
I would do more if more were needful. Look, here comes one, a gentlewoman of mine, who, falling in the flaws of her youth, hath blistered her report. She is with child, and he that got it, sentenced, though a man more fit to do another such offence than to die for this.
When must he die?
As I do think tomorrow. Stay a while. I have provided for you. You will be conducted.
Repent you, fair one, of the sin you carry?
I do, and bear the shame most patiently.
I will teach you how to try your penitence and arraign your conscience, whether it be sound or hollowly put on.
I'll gladly learn.
Love you the man who wronged you? Why then, was your most offenceful act mutually committed?
Mutually.
Why then, was your sin of heavier kind than his?
I confess it, and repent it, Father.
'Tis meet so, daughter, lest you do repent the sin that has brought you to this shame, whose sorrow is always towards ourselves, not heaven. For as we stand in fear...
I do repent me as it is an evil.
There rest. Your partner, as I understand it, must die tomorrow. I go to him with instruction. Greystoke with you. Better to see to.
Must die tomorrow? Oh, injurious love, that respites me a life whose very comfort is still a dying horror. 'Tis pity of him.
When I do pray and think, I think and pray to several subjects. Heaven hath my empty words. My invention, hearing not my tongue, anchors on Isabel. God in my mouth, as if I did but chew his name, but in my heart, the strong and swelling evil of my conception. The state wherein I studied is a good thing, being often read, grown seared, yea, my gravity, wherein, let no man hear me, I do take pride, I could with boot change to an idle plume, which the air beats for vain. O place, O form, how often have thy, with thy case, thy habit, wrenched awe from fools, and tied more wiser souls to thy false seeming. Blood, thou art blood. Let's write good angel on the devil's horn. 'Tis not the devil's crest. How now? Who's there?
One, Isabel, assistant, desires access to you.
Teach her the way. Heavens, why does my blood muster to my heart, making it both unable to itself and dispossessing all my other parts of necessary fitness? So play the foolish throngs with he that swoons. Come all to help him, and stop the breath wherein he should revive. Even so the general, subject to a well-wished king, quits their own part, and with obsequious fondness
crowds to his presence, where their untaught love must needs appear offence. How now, fair lady?
I've come to know your pleasure.
That you should know it would please me more than you should demand what it is. Your brother cannot live.
Even so, heaven keep your honor.
And yet, he may live for a while. And that may be as long as you or I, yet he must die.
Undo your sentence.
Oh,
when, I beseech you, that in his reprieve, longer or shorter, he may be so fitted that his soul sicken not.
Why, these filthy vices? 'Twould be better to pardon him that hath stolen from nature, a man already made to remit the saucy sweetness that it is to coin God's image in stamps that are forbid. It is all as easy to take away falsely a life true made, as 'tis to put metal in restrained means to make a false one.
'Tis set down so in heaven, but not in earth.
Say you so? Then I will propose you. Which would you prefer? That the most just law should take your brother's life, or to redeem him, you should give up your body to that sweet uncleanness, as she that he hath stained?
So believe this, I had rather give my body than my soul.
I talk not of souls. Compelled sins stand more to number than to account.
How say you?
Hey, I'll not warrant that, for I can argue against what I say. But answer to this, that I, now the voice of the recorded law, do pronounce a sentence on your brother's life. Might there not be some charity in sin to save that brother's life?
Will please you to do it. I'll take it as a peril to my soul. It is no sin at all, but charity.
Were you to do it at peril to your soul, would be equal poise to sin and charity.
That I do beg his life, if it be sin, heaven let me bear it. You, granting of my suit, if that be sin, I'll make it my morn prayer and have it added to the faults of mine and nothing of your answer.
Nay, but hear me, your sense pursues not mine. Either you are ignorant or seem so craftily, and that's not good.
Let me be ignorant and in nothing good, but graciously to know I am no better.
Brother is to die.
So.
And his offence, as it appears, is accounted to the law upon that pain.
True.
Admit no other way to say, as I subscribe not that or any other, but in the loss of person, that you resist being so desired by someone whose credit with the judge or own great place could fetch your brother from the manacles of the all-binding law. And that there be no earthly means to save him, but that you should lay down the treasures of your body to this suppose, or else let him suffer. Which would you do?
As much my poor self, my brother, as myself, that is where I under the terms of death. For the impressions of keen whips I'd wear as rubies, and strip myself to death as to a bed that longing had been sick for air, I would yield my body up to shame.
Then your brother must die.
And 'twere the cheaper way. Better it were a brother die at once than a sister by redeeming him should die forever.
Were you not then as cruel as the sentence you slander, sir?
Ignominy and ransom and free pardon are of two houses. For lawful mercy is nothing kin to foul redemption.
You seemed of late to make a tyrant of the law, and rather prove that sliding of your brother a merriment rather than a vice.
Pardon me, my lord, it oft falls out. To have what we would have, we speak not what we mean. I something to excuse the thing I hate, for his advantage that I dearly love.
We are all friends.
Else let my brother die. If not a Federy, but only he, owe and succeed thy weakness.
Nay, women are friends.
Ay, as the glasses where they view themselves, which are as easy broke as they make fall. Women, help heaven. Men, their creation mar in profiting by them. Nay, call us 10 times frail. We are soft as our complexion, and credulous to false prints.
I think it well. And from this testimony of your own sex, and since I suppose we are made to be no stronger than the faults that shake our frame, let me be bold. I do arrest your words. Be that you are a woman, and if you be more, none. And if you are one, as you are well expressed, all external bodies. Show it now by putting on the best.
have no tongue with one. Let me entreat you speak the former language.
Plainly conceived. I love you.
My brother did love Juliet, and you tell me he shall die for it.
He shall not, Isabel, if you can give me love.
I see your virtue had the license in it that seems a little fouler than it is to pluck on others.
Against you and my place in the state will so overcome your accusation that you shall stifle in your own report and smell of calumny. I have begun, and I do give my sensual race the rein. Fit thy consent to my sharp accusations. Lay aside the nonsense and pernicious blushes which betray what they do conceal. Redeem your brother by making good body. Now drives me most. I'll make a tyrant of him. As for you, say what you can. My faults always your truth.
To whom should I complain? For did I tell this, who would believe me? Oh, perilous mouths that bear in them one and the selfsame tongue, bidding the law make curtsy to their will, looking both right and wrong to the appetites. Follow as it draws. I'll to my brother, though he hath fallen by prompture of the blood. Or yet hath he in him such a mind of honour, or that had he 20 heads to tender down on 20 bloody blocks, or he'd yield them up before his sister should her body stoop to such abhorred pollution. Then Isabel lived chaste and brother died. More than our brother is our chastity. I'll tell him yet of Angelo's request, and fit his mind to death. Souls rest.
So, you hope of pardon from Lord Angelo?
The miserable have no other medicine, but only hope. I hope to live, but I am prepared to die.
Be absolute for death. Life or death will thereby seem the sweeter.
Who's there? Come in. The wish deserves a welcome.
Yes, sir. How long I'll call on you again.
Most holy sir, I thank you.
My business is a word or two for Claudia.
And most welcome. Look, Signor, it's your sister.
A word with you promised.
As many as you please.
Bring me to hear them speak, where I may be concealed.
That sister wants the comfort.
Why, as all comforts are. Most good indeed. Lord Angelo, having affairs to heaven, intends you for his swift ambassador, where you shall be an everlasting legion. Well, therefore, your appointment make with speed. Tomorrow you set on.
Is there no remedy?
None, but such a remedy as to save a head, to cleave a heart in twain.
Is there any?
Yes, brother, you may live. Oh, there is a devilish mercy in the judge, that if you'll implore it, will free your life, but fetter you till death.
Perpetual durance?
Aye, just. Perpetual durance, a restraint, though all the world's fastidity you had to 8 term in scope.
But in what nature?
In such a one as you consenting to it. I would bark the honour from the trunk you bear and leave you naked.
Let me know the point.
I fear thee, Claudio, and I quake, lest thou a feverous life shouldst entertain, and 6 or 7 winters more respect than a perpetual honour. Or darest thou die? The sense of death is most in apprehension. The poor beetle that we tread upon in corporal sufferance finds a pang as great as when a giant dies.
Why give you me the shame? Think you I can a resolution fetch from flowery tenderness? If I must die, I will encounter darkness as a bride, and hug it in mine arms.
There spake my brother.
for there my father's grave did utter forth a voice. Oh yes, thou must die. Thou art too noble to conserve a life in base appliances. This outward sainted deputy, whose settled visage and deliberate word nips youth in the head, and follies doth amuse, falcon doth the fowl, is yet the devil. His filth within being cast, he would appear a pond as deep as hell.
The princely Angelo.
Tis cunning livery of hell, this damnest body to invest and cover in princely guards. Or dost thou think, Claudia, if I would yield him my virginity, thou mightst be freed?
Ah, heavens, it cannot be.
Yes, he would give it thee. Then this rank offence, so to offend him still. Tonight's the time that I must do what I abhor to name, or else thou diest tomorrow.
No, 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 no! Thou shalt not do it.
Word with my life. I throw it down for your deliverance as frankly as a pin.
Thanks, dear Isabel.
Be ready, Claudio, for your death tomorrow.
Yes. Has he affections in him that thus can make him bite the law by the nose? Sure, it is no sin. Or up the deadly seven, it is the least.
Which is the least?
If it were damnable, he being so wise. Why would he, for the momentary trick, be so perjurably fined? Oh, Isabel!
What sayest thou, my brother?
Death is a fearful thing.
And shame in life a hateful.
Aye, but to die, and go we know not where, to lie in cold obstruction and to rot. This sensible, warm motion to become a kneaded clod, and the delighted spirit to bathe in fiery floods, or to reside in thrilling regions of thick-ribbed ice, to be imprisoned in the viewless winds, and blown with restless violence round about this pendant world, or to be worse than worse, those that lawless and uncertain thoughts imagine howling. 'Tis too horrible. The weariest and most loathed worldly life that age, penury and imprisonment can lay down on nature. It's a paradise to what we fear of death.
Alas, alas.
Sweet sister, let me live. What sin you do to save a brother's life? Nature dispenses with the deeds of father and it becomes a virtue.
Beast! Faithless coward! Dishonest wretch! Wilt thou be made a man out of my life? Is it not a kind of incest to take life from thine own sister's shame? What should I think? Heaven shield my mother played my father fair, but such a warped slip of wilderness ne'er issued from his blood. Take my defiance. Guide. Perish. My bending down.
Hey, hear me, Isabel!
Fine! A sin's not accidental, but a trade. Mercy to thee would prove itself aboard.
Oh, hear me, Isabel!
It is best thou diest quickly.
Don't say the word, young sister, but one word.
What is your will?
If you might dispense with your leisure, I would by and by have some word with you. The satisfaction I would require would likewise be to your own benefit.
I have no superfluous leisure. My stay must be stolen out of other affairs, but I will attend thee a while.
What has passed between yourself and your sister, fortune conveyed to my ears? Lord Angelo never had cause to corrupt her. He hath merely made an assay of her virtue to practice his judgment with the disposition of sins. She, having been the very soul of grace, has given him that gracious denial that he, for which he sought. Therefore, prepare thyself to death. Do not satisfy your resolution with hopes that are fallible. Tomorrow you must die. Go to your knees to me.
Let me ask my sister pardon. I am so out of love with life that I can soon be rid of it.
There, Christine. There you are.
That the hand that has made you fair, as good has made you fair. For the goodness that is cheap in beauty makes beauty brief in goodness. But birth grace, which is the very soul of your complexion, shall keep the body of it ever fair. The assault that Angelo hath made to you, fortune has conveyed to my understanding, and but that frailty hath examples for his falling, I would wonder.
content this substitute and save your brother.
I'm going now to resolve it. I'd rather my brother die by the law than my son be unlawfully born. But oh, how much is the good Duke deceived in Angelo. If ever he return and I can speak to him, I shall open my lips in vain or discover his government.
That shall not be much amiss. But as things stand, he will escape your accusation. He made trial of you only. Therefore, fasten your ears on my advices. By the love I have of doing good, a remedy presents itself. I do make myself believe that you may most uprighteously do a poor, wronged lady a merited benefit. Save your brother from the angry law, do no stain upon your own gracious person, and much please the absent Duke, if peradventure he should ever return to have hearing of this business.
Show me how, good father. I have truth and spirit to do anything that appears not foul in the truth of my spirit.
Virtue is ever bold and goodness never fearful. Hearest thou of Mariana, the sister of Frederick, the great soldier who miscarried at sea?
I have heard of the lady, and good words went with her name.
Now she, should this Angelo have married, was affianced to him by oath and the nuptial appointed, between which time of the contract and limit of solemnity, her brother was wrecked at sea, having with him in that perished vessel her marriage dowry. Now, mark how heavily this befell the poor gentlewoman. First, she lost a noble and renowned brother, in his affections to her ever most kind and natural. And with him, the portion and sinew of her fortune, her marriage dowry. And with both, a combinate husband, this well-seeming Angelo.
Can this be so? Did Angelo so leave her?
Left her in tears and wiped not a one of them with his comfort.
What a merit were it in death to take this poor maid from the world. What corruption in life that it would let this man live. But how out of this can she avail?
The remedy, it is a rupture that you may easily heal, and the curing of it not only saves your brother, but keeps you from dishonor in doing it.
Show me how, good father.
This aforenamed maid hath in her yet the continuation of her first affection. His unjust unkindness that by all reason should have quit her love hath, like an impediment in the current, only served to make it more violent and unruly. Goest thou to Angelo. Answer his requirings with plausible obedience. Agree with his demands to the point. Only reserve yourself to this advantage. First, that your stay with him may not be long. Second, that the place shall have all shadow and silence in it. And third, that the time answer to convenience. This being agreed in course, and here comes all, we shall advise this wronged maid to stead up your appointment. Go in your place. If this encounter reveal itself hereafter, it may compel him to recompense. And here, by this, is your brother saved, the poor Mariana advantaged, the corrupt deputy scaled. The maid will I frame and make ready for this business. If you think good to do this as you might, the doubleness of your benefit defends the deceit from any reproof. What think you of it?
The image of it gives me content already, and I trust it will grow to a most prosperous perfection.
It lies much in your holding up. Goest thou to Angelo, and if for this night he entreats you to his bed, give him promise of satisfaction. I will shortly to St. Luke's. There, by the moated grange, resides this poor, dejected Mariana. Come to me there, and dispatch with Angelo that it may be soon.
I thank you for this comfort. Farewell, good father.
Say, if there be no remedy for it, but you must buy and sell men and women like beasts, then we shall have the whole world drink drowned and bite bastard.
Bastard.
Your ways. Oh! Bless you, good father friar.
And you, good sister daughter. What offence has this man done to you?
Marry, sir, he hath offended the law. And, sir, we think him to be a thief also, for we have found upon him a most peculiar pink lock, which we sent to the deputy.
Viscerer, a bawd, a wicked bawd, the evil that thou causest to be done, this is thy means to live. Go, men, go, men.
Indeed it does stink of some sort, sir, but yet I would...
Away with him to prison, officer!
He must...
Correction and instruction must both work ere this rude beast profits.
Indeed, he must be for the deputy, sir, for he has been given a warning. The deputy does detest a poor master.
Haste thy comfort, I cry bail. Here comes a gentleman who's a friend of mine.
How now, noble Pompey? No, I'm going to prison, Pompey.
Faith, sir, yes.
Dead Pompey or how?
For being a bawd, sir, for being a bawd.
Well then, imprison him.
I was hoping, sir, your good worship would be my bail.
No, indeed I will not, Pompey. It is not the wear. I will pray for you, Pompey, to increase your bondage. I do, trusty Pompey. Bless you, Fra.
Oh, and you?
Come your way, sir.
Go to kennel, Pompey, go.
Come, sir.
What news, Fra, of the Duke?
I know of none. Can you tell me a bit?
Some say that he's with the Emperor of Russia. Others some that he's in Rome, but where is he, think you?
Well, I know not where, but wheresoever, I wish him well.
There's a mad, fantastical trick of him to steal from the slaves and thus usurp the beggary he was never born to. Lord Angelo dukes it well in his absence. He puts transgression to it.
He does well in it.
Little more leans into lechery, would do no harm in him, Fra. Something too crabbed that way.
It is too general a vice, and severity must cure it.
Yes, in good sooth, the vices of a great kindred, it is well allied, but it is impossible to extirp it quite till eating and drinking be put down. They say that this Angelo was not made by man and woman of this downright way of creation. What think you?
Why then, how should he be made?
Well, some report that a sea maid spawned him, others that he was begot between two stockfishes. But it is certain that when he makes water, his urine is congealed ice. That I know to be.
Sir, you are pleasant and you speak apace.
Why, what ruthless thing is it in him for the rebellion of a codpiece to take away the life of a man? Would the Duke in his absence have done this? No, no. He had some fiend for sport. He knew the service, and that instructed him to mercy.
Sir, I have not heard the absent Duke much detected for women.
Oh, sir, you are deceived.
It is not possible.
Who? Not the Duke? Yes, your beggar of 50. And his use is to put a ducat in her clack dish.
You do him wrong, surely.
Shh. Sir, I was an inward of his. Chime, clawing fellow was the Duke, and I believe that I know the cause of it.
Why then, what should be the cause?
No, pray thee. It is a secret that must be locked within teeth and lips. But this I can let you learn, I know. The greatest subject of the file held the Duke to be wise.
Wise? Well, no doubt that he was.
No, very superficial, ignorant, unweighing fellow.
Either this is envy in you, folly, or mistaking.
Sir, I know him and I love him.
Love speaks with better knowledge, and knowledge with dearer love.
Come, sir, I know what I know.
I can hardly believe that, as thou knowest not what thou speak. But if ever the Duke return, as our prayers are he may, let me require you to make your answer before him. If this be truth you have spoken, you have courage to maintain it. Sir, I am bound to call upon you, and I prithee your name.
Sir, my name is Lucio, well known to the Duke.
He shall know you better, sir, if I live to report you.
I think not. Canst tell if Claudio die tomorrow or no?
Why, sir, should he die?
Why? For filling a bottle with a tun dish. I would the Duke speak of a return. Marry, this ungenitous agent will unpeople the province with continency. Sparrows must not nest in his houses, because they are lecherous. The Duke yet should have dark deeds darkly answered, could never bring them to light. I would he were returned. Marry, this Claudio is condemned for untrussing. Farewell, Fra. I prithee pray for me. The Duke, I say to thee again, would have mutton on Fridays. He's now past it. Yet, and I say to thee again, the Duke would mow with a beggar, though she smells of brown bread and garlic. Say that I said so. Farewell.
No might nor greatness in mortality can censure scape. Back wounding calumny, the whitest virtue strikes. What king so strong he can tie up the gall in a slanderous tongue? Oh, who comes here?
Go, away with her to prison. Good, my lady. Be good to me. Your honor is accounted a merciful woman. Good, my lady.
Double and treble admonition, and still forfeit in the same kind. This would make mercy swear and pay the tyrant.
A board of some 11 years. Continuance, may it please your honour. My lady, Mrs. Winlucio has information against me. Mistress Kate Keydown was with child by you in due time. You promised her marriage. His child was a year and a quarter confirmed, Philip and Jacob. I kept this myself, and see how he goes about to abuse me.
That fellow is a fellow of much license. Let him be called before us. Away with her to prison. Go to, no more words. Provost? My brother will not be altered. Claudio must die tomorrow. Let him be furnished with divines and have all charitable preparation. If my brother wrought by my pity, it should not be so with him.
So please you, this friar has been with him and entertained him for this preparation for death.
Blessings be upon you.
Whence are you?
Not of this province, though it is my business to use it for my time. I am a friar of gracious order, late come from the sea on special business from His Holiness.
And let me desire to know how you find Claudio prepared. I'm to understand you've led some hesitation.
He claims to have received no sinister measure from his judge, but most willingly humbles himself to the determinations of the law. Yet, had he framed to himself many deceiving promises of life, which I, by my good leisure, have put him off, and now he is resolved to die.
You have paid the heavens your function, and the prisoner the very debt of your calling. I've laboured for the poor gentleman, but my brother Justice have I found so severe that he has forced me to tell him that he is indeed Justice.
If the straightness of his life answer the straightness of his dealings, it shall do him well. Wherein he chanced to fail, he has sentenced himself.
I'm going to see the prisoner. Fare you well.
Peace, Golden.
He whom heaven's sword would bear should be as holy as severe. Pattern in himself to know, grace to stand, and virtue go. More nor less to others paying than myself offences weigh. Shame on him whose cruel striking kills for faults of his own liking. And twice treble shame to Angela, to weed my vice and let his grow. Oh, what may man within him hide, though an angel on the outward side. Craft against vice I must apply. Tonight, with Angelo, shall lie his old betrothed but despised. Hence shall disguise by the disguised pay with falsehood false extracted, and perform an old contract.
I shall cry.
crave your forbearance a little. Perhaps later I will call upon you for some advantage to yourself?
I avoid that.
Greetings, young daughter. What news from this good deputy?
He had the garden succumbed with brick, whose western side is with the vineyard backed. To this vineyard is a planchard gate that makes its opening with this bigger key. This other doth command a little door, that from the vineyard to the garden leads. And there have I made my promise, upon the heavy middle of the night, to call upon him.
Shall you, upon your knowledge, find you this way?
I have taken a due and wary note upon it, with whispering and most guilty diligence. In action of all proceed, he did show me the way twice, Owen.
And are there no other tokens greed twixt you concerning her observance?
No, none, but only a repair in the dark. And that I have possessed him, my most stay can be but brief. I have made him know I have a servant with me comes along, who stays upon me, whose persuasion is I come about my brother.
It is well borne up. Now, I have not yet made known to Mariana a word of this. What ho, within, come hither. Now, I pray you make acquaintance of this maid. She comes to do you good.
I do desire the like.
Now, do you persuade yourself that I respect you?
Good friar, I know you should do exactly.
Then take you this, your companion, by the hand. She hath a tale made ready for your ears. I will attend your leisure. But make haste, the vaporous night approaches.
Would it please talk about?
Place and greatness. Thousands of eyes are stuck upon thee. Volumes of reports run with these false and contrarious quests upon thy doings. Thousand escapes of wits make thee the father of their idle dreams and rack thee in their fancies. Welcome, Halibur.
She will take the enterprise, father, if you advise it.
It is not my entreaty, it is not my consent, but my entreaty too.
Little have you to say when you leave him, but soft and low, remember now my brother.
Fear me not.
Nor, gentle daughter, fear you not at all. He is your husband on a pre-contract. To bring you thus together, it is no sin, since at the justice of your title to him doth flourish the deceit. Now, let us go. Our corns to reap, for yet our tithe to sow.
Come hither, sinner! Can you cut off a man's head?
If the man be a bachelor, I can, ma'am. But if he's a married man, then he's his wife's head, and I could not cut off a woman's head.
Come, sir, leave me your snatches and yield me a direct answer. Tomorrow are to die Claudio and Barnardine. Here is, in our prison, a common executioner who in his office lacks a helper. If you will take it on you to assist him, it will redeem you of your gifts. If not, you will serve your full time of imprisonment with a deliverance of an unpitied whipping. But you have been a notorious board.
I've been an unlawful board for time out of mind, ma'am, but yet I would be content to be a lawful hangman. I would be glad to receive instruction from my fellow partner.
What are aboard, son? Where's a board from there?
Are you cool, madam?
Yeah. Here's a fella will help you in your execution. If you think meet, compound with him by the year. If not, use him for the present and dismiss him. He cannot plead his estimation with you, for he hath been a bawd.
A bawd, madam? Fie on him. He will discredit our mystery.
Go to, you both weigh equally. A feather would turn the scale.
Pray, sir, a good favour. For I'm sure you have a good favour to give, but you do have that hanging look. You call, sir, your trade a mystery?
Aye, sir, a mystery.
Payton, sir, I'm told, is a mystery. Your whores, being my occupation, and using Payton, do prove my occupation a mystery. But what mystery there should be in hanging? I was hanged myself, I wouldn't imagine.
Sir, it is a mystery.
Proof?
Well, every true man's apparel fits your thief.
The clothes are too small for your thief. True man thinks them big enough. Your clothes. bones are too big for your thief. Your thief thinks them little enough. So all true man's apparel fits your thief.
Are you agreed?
I will serve him, ma'am, for I do find the hangman a more penitent trade than the board. He doth more often ask forgiveness.
Will you, sirrah, fetch your block and your axe 4 o'clock tomorrow?
Come on, board.
I do desire to learn.
I will teach you my trade.
Oh, call hither Bernardine and Claudio. Though one has my pity, not a jot the other, being a murderer, even though he my brother. Look, here's the warrant, Claudio, for thy death. It is now at dead midnight. By 8 tomorrow, thou must be made immortal. Where's Barnardine?
As fast locked up in sleep as guiltless labour, when it lies in the traveller's bones, he will not wake.
Oh, who can do good on him? Oh, go and prepare thyself. But hark, what noise? Heaven give thy spirits comfort. By and by, oh, perhaps it is some reprieve or pardon for the most gentle Claudio. Ah, oh, welcome, Father.
The best and wholesomest spirits of the morning be upon you. Who hath called for me here?
None since the curfew rang.
Not Isabel?
No.
They will then ere it be long.
What comfort?
What comfort for Claudio?
There's some in hope.
Tis a bitter deputy.
Not so, not so. His life is paralleled even with the stroke and line of his great judgment. He doth, with holy abstinence, subdue that within himself that he spurs on his powers to punish in others. Now, were he mealed with that he corrects, then were he tyrannous. But this being so, he's just. Oh, what's that noise? This is a good promise. Seldom when the steeled jailer is the friend of man. How now, what lawyer? That spirit possessed with haste who wounds the assisting postern with his strokes.
Oh, there he must stay until he's awakened and he's called up.
Have you no countermand yet for Claudio but that he must die tomorrow?
None, sir, none.
Well, as near the morning as it is, provost, you shall hear more ere dawn.
Happily you something know. But I believe there comes no countermand, no such example of we. Besides, upon the very siege of justice, Lord Angelo hath proclaimed it to the public ear to the contrary.
This is his lordship's messenger, and here is Claudio's pardon. This is Claudio's pardon, purchased with such sin as the pardoner himself is in. Hence has offence its quick celerity when it is borne in high authority. When vice makes mercy, mercy is so extended that for the false love is the offender friendly. What news?
I told you, Lord Angelo, belike thinking me remiss in mine office, hath awakened me with this unwonted putting on. Methinks strangely, for he had not used it before.
Let us hear it.
Whatsoever you may hear to the contrary, let Claudio be executed by 4 of the clock, and in the afternoon, Barnardine. For my better satisfaction, let me have Claudio's head sent me by 5. Let this duly be performed with the thought that more depends on it than we must yet deliver. Thus, not fail to do your office, as you will answer it at your peril. What say you to this, sir?
What is this Barnardine who must be executed in the afternoon?
A Bohemian born, though nursed up and bred here, and a prisoner of some 9 years.
How is it that the absent Duke has not either given him his liberty or put him to death? I have heard that was ever his way to do so.
His friend still brought reprieves for him, and indeed is fact, until now in the government of Lord Angelo came not to an undoubted proof.
It is now apparent.
Most manifest, and not denied by himself.
Hath he borne himself penitently in prison? How seems he to be touched?
A man that apprehends death no more than in a drunken sleep. Oh, careless, reckless, and fearless of what's past, present, or to come. Insensible to mortality, but desperately mortal.
wants advice.
He will hear none. He hath evermore had the liberty of the prison. Given leave to escape, he would not. Drunk many times a day, if not entirely drunk, all day. Oh, we have oft awakened him as if taken to execution, and even showed him a seeming warrant to the effect. He has not been moved at all.
More of him anon. There is written in your brow, promise, honesty and constancy. My skill beguiles me if it be not so. Yet, in the boldness of my cunning, I will put myself in hazard. This Claudio, whom in your hand you hold a warrant for the execution, is no more in forfeit to the law than Angelo who sentences him. Now, to make this known to you in manifested effect, I crave but 4 days' grace, for the which you must do me a present and a dangerous courtesy.
Pray, sir, in what?
In the delaying death.
Alas, how can this be done, having the hour limited and an express command under penalty to have his head delivered to Lord Angelo's in his view? I may make my case in the strongest to cross this.
By my holy vows do I warrant you, if my instructions be my guide. Let this Barnardine be this morning executed and his head carried to Angelo.
Angelo hath seen them both. He will discover the favour.
Death a great disguiser, and you may add to it. Shave the head, and say it was the desire of the penitent so to be bared before his death. You know the cause is common. If anything fall to you from this other than thanks and good fortune, by the saint I profess, I will plead against it with my life.
Pardon me, good father, it is against my oath.
Were you sworn to the Duke or to the death?
To him and to his substitutes.
Then you will think you have done nothing wrong if the Duke avouch the justice of your dealings.
But what likelihood is there of that?
Not a resemblance, but a certainty. Yet since I see that neither my vows, nor my integrity, nor my persuasion can with ease attempt you, I will go further than I intended to pluck all fears out of you. Look you here. This is the hand and seal of the Duke. You know the character, I'm sure, and the signet is not strange to you.
I know them both.
Well, the contents of this is a return of the Duke. You shall soon read this over at your leisure, wherein you shall learn that within these 2 days he will be here. Now, this is a thing that Angelo knows not, for he this day receives letters of strange tenure, perchance of the Duke's death, perchance of him entering into some monastery, but by chance nothing of what is here writ. Look, the morning sun calls upon the shepherdess. Put yourself not into amazement how these things should be. All difficulties are easy once they are known. Call up your men and off with Barnardine's head. I will give him a present shrift and advise him for a better place. Yet still you stand amazed, but this shall absolutely resolve you. Come away, it is almost present dawn.
I'm as well acquainted here as I was in her ancient profession. One would think it was Mistress Overdone's own house. Here be so many of our old customers.
Sirrah, bring Barnardine hither.
Mr. Barnardine! Awake and be hanged, Mr.
Oh,
Barnardine! Be so good, sir, as to rise and be executed.
Away, you rogue, away! I am sleeping. Tell him he must awake, and quickly too.
Pray, sir, awake and be put to death. Sleep afterwards.
Go in there and fetch him out.
He's coming, sir, he's coming. I can hear his straw rustle.
Is the axe upon the block,
sir? Is the axe upon the block, sir?
Very ready, sir.
I would have you clap you in your prayers, sir, for hark you, the warrant has come.
You rogue! Why have you tricked
Look you, sir. Here comes your ghostly friar. Think we jest now?
Sir, bound by my charity and hearing how quickly you are to depart, I come to talk to you, instruct you, and pray with you.
Friar, no! I have been drinking hard all night, and I will have more time to prepare me, or I shall beat out my brains with fillets. I will not consent to die this day, that's certain.
Oh, sir, you must, and therefore look you forward on the journey you must go.
I swear I will not die today for any man's persuasion.
But hear you. Ungrateful wretch! And fit to live or die. After him, fellows, and bring him to the block.
Now, sir, how do you find the prisoner?
A creature unprepared, unmeet for death. To transport him in such a mind for damage.
A man of Claudio's years.
Claudio's years. His hair and skin just of his colour. What if we do admit this reprobate until he were well inclined and satisfy the deputy with the visage of Ragazine, more like to Claudio?
Oh, it is an accident that heaven provides. Dispatch it quickly and see that it is sent according to command while I persuade this rude wretch willingly to die.
This shall be done presently, good father. But what shall we... The Barnardine must die at 4 o'clock. And what shall be done with Claudio to save me from the danger that I may perceive if it was known he was still alive?
Let this be done. Put them in secret hold, Claudio and Barnardine both. Ere twice the sun has made his journal greeting to yon generation, you shall find your safety manifested.
I'm your free dependent.
Now... Letters will I write to Varius, the provost, he shall bear them, which shall report that I am near at home and bound by great injunctions to enter publicly. He shall I require to meet me a league below the city, and there, with cold gradation and well-balanced form, we shall proceed with Angelo.
Here is the head. I shall carry it myself.
Fortunate it is. Go, dispatch it instantly.
I'll make all speed.
This hope we hear.
The tongue of Isabel. She has come to know if yet her brother's pardon be brought hither. Yet I must keep her ignorant of her good, to make her heavenly comfort of despair when it is least expected. Blessings be upon you, young daughter.
Better given me by so holy a man. Hath yet the deputy sent to my brother's pardon?
He hath released him, Isabel, from the world. His head is off and sent to Angela.
Nay, it is not so.
It is no other. Now show your wisdom now by your close patience.
I will to him and pluck out his eye!
He will not be admitted to his sight. Which you will find in every syllable a faithful verity. The Duke returns tomorrow. Nay, dry your eyes. One of our convent and his confessor doth give me this instant. Now, this is a thing that Claudio, even now letters are sent to Aeschylus and Angelo, who prepare to meet him at the city gates, there to relinquish their power. Now, pace you your wisdom in the good steps that I would have it go, and you shall have your bosom on this wretch, justice to your heart, and general honour.
I am directed by you.
Take you this letter to Friar Peter. It is that he gave me of the Duke's return. Say by this token I desire his presence at Mariana's house tonight. There, your cause and hers.
choose him home and home. For my poor self, I am combined by a sacred vow and must be absent. When do your way to this letter, and wipe this record of waters from your face with light heart. Trust not my order if I can let you. Who's here?
Good evening, Friar. Where's the prof?
She's not within, sir.
Unshapes me quite, makes me unpregnant and dull to all proceedings. A deflowered maid, and by an eminent body that did enforce the law against it. But that her tender shame will not proclaim against her maiden loss, how might she tell me? Yet reason dares her know, for my authority bears a credent bulk that no particular shame may once attach itself to. But it shall confound the breather. He should have lived, save that his riotous youth and dangerous sense might in the course of time have taken revenge, being so offered a dishonored life with ransom of such shame. Yet would that he have lived. Alack, when once our grace we have forgot, nothing goes right. We would, and we would not.
To speak so indirectly, I am loath. I would say the truth, but to accuse him so, that is your part. But he says I am advised to do it. He says to bail for purpose. He ruled by it. Besides, he says that if peradventure he speak against him in the adverse side, I should not think it strange, but 'tis a physic that's bitter.
My noble and well-warranted cousin, well met. My old and faithful friend, it's good to see you.
A happy return be to your royal grace.
Thanks be to you both. We have made inquiries of you, and we have heard such goodness of your justice that we could not help but yield ourselves forth to public thanks for running more requital.
You make my bonds still great.
Give me your hand.
and let the subjects see that they might know that outward courtesies would fain proclaim favors that are kept within. Aeschylus, come, walk with me on my other side, and good support as you are.
Justice, her royal Duke, veil your regard upon a wronged, I would fain have said a maid. Her worthy prince, dishonor not your eye by throwing it on any other object till you have heard me in my true complaint and given me justice.
Well, relate your wrongs. In what? By whom? Be brief. Here is Lord Angelo shall give you justice. Reveal yourself to him.
My worthy Duke, you bid me seek redemption of the devil. Hear me yourself, for that which I must speak must either punish me not being believed or wring redress from you. Hear me or hear me.
My lord, I fear her wits are not firm. She hath been a suitor to me for her brother, cut off by course of justice.
By course of justice.
And she will speak most bitterly and strange.
Most strange, yet most truly will I speak. That Angelo's forsworn, is it not strange? That Angelo's a murderer, is not strange? That Angelo's an adulterous thief and hypocrite, a virgin violator, is not strange and strange?
Nay, it is 10 times strange.
Prince, I conjure thee, as thou believest there is another comfort than this world, neglect me not with that opinion that I am touched with madness, or make not impossible that which but seems unlike. 'Tis not impossible, but one, the wickedest caitiff on the ground, may seem as shy, as grave, as just, as absolute as Angelo. Even so may Angelo, in all his dressings, carracks, titles, forms, be an arch-villain. Oh, believe it, royal prince, if he be less, he's nothing. But he's more, had I more name for badness.
If she be mad, as I believe no other, her madness has the oddest frame of sense. Such a dependency of thing on thing as I e'er heard in madness.
Worthy Duke, harp not on that, nor do not banish reason for inequality. But let your reason serve to make the truth appear where it seems hid, and hide the false seems true.
Many who are not mad have sure more lack of reason. What say you?
I am the sister of one Claudio, condemned upon the act of fornication to lose his head, condemned by Angelo. I, in probation of a sisterhood, was sent to by my brother, one Lucio, as then the messenger.
That's I, my lord. And to like your grace, I came to her from Claudio and desired her to try her gracious fortune with Lord Angelo, for her poor brother's pardon.
That's he indeed.
Sir, you were not bid to speak.
No, my lord, nor wish to hold my peace.
I wish you now, then, take heed of it. And when you have a business for yourself, pray you then be perfect.
I warrant your honour.
A warrant for yourself, take heed of it.
This gentleman told somewhat of my tale.
Right?
It may be right, but you are in the wrong to speak before your time. Proceed.
I went to this pernicious caitiff deputy.
That's somewhat madly spoken.
Pardon it, the phrase is to the matter.
Mend it again. The matter. Proceed.
In brief, to set this needless process by, how I persuaded, how I prayed and kneeled, how he refelled me, and how I replied, for this was of much length. This vile conclusion I now begin with grief and shame to utter. He would not, but by gift of my chaste body to his ardent intemperate lust, release my brother. And after much debatement, my sisterly remorse confutes mine honour, and I did yield to him. But the next morn betimes, his purpose suffiting, he sends a warrant for my poor brother's head.
This is most likely.
Oh, that it were as like as it is true.
Oh, fond wretch, thou knowest not what thou speaks. Or else you are a git butter, or else you are turned against this man in some practice. First, his honour stands without blemish. Second, it imports no reason that he should with such vehemency pursue faults proper to himself. If he had so offended, he would have weighed your brother as himself and not cut him off. This must needs be a practice. Say by whose advice you came here to complain.
And is this all? Then, oh, you blessed ministers above, keep me in patience, where in ripened time unfold evil here wrapped up in countenance. Heaven shield your grace from woe, as I thus wronged, hence unbelieved go.
I know you've claimed the god, an officer, take hold on her. Shall we thus permit a blasting and a scandalous breath on one so near ourselves? This must needs be a practice. Say, who knew of your intent in coming hither?
One that I would were here, Friar Lodovick.
A ghostly friar, belike. Who knows this Lodovick?
My lord! I know him. It is a meddling friar. I do not like the man. Had he been lame, my lord, the certain words he spake against your grace in your retirement, I had swinged him soundly.
Words against ourselves? This is a good friar, belike. And to set this wretched woman on against our substitute, let this friar be found.
Yes, to my lord. She and that friar, I saw them in prison.
A saucy friar.
Friar, very scurvy fellow.
Blessed be my royal grace. I've stood by, my lord, and I've heard your rule here abused. First of this woman, most wrongfully accused your substitute, who is as free from touch or sore with her as she from all and got.
We did believe no less. Know you this friar, Lodovick?
I know him for a man divine and holy. Not scurvy, nor a temporary meddler, as he's reported by this gentleman. And upon my honour, a man who never yet did, as he vouches, misreport your grace.
Oh, my lord, most villainously. Believe it.
What he in time may come to clear himself. But at present he is sick, my honour, of a strange illness. Being come to knowledge that there was a complaint tendered against Lord Angelo, came I hither to speak as from his mouth what he knows to be true and false, and what he shall make all full clear whensoever he's convented. First to this woman, her she here disproved to her own eyes, till she herself confessed it.
Good friar, let's hear it. Do you not smile at this Lord Angelo? Oh heavens, the vanity of wretched fools. Come, in this I'll be impartial. Be you the judge of your own cause. Is this the witness for Lord Angelo? First, let her bear her face and after speak.
Pardon, my lord, I will not show my face until my husband bids me.
What? Are you married?
No, my lord.
Are you a maid?
No, my lord.
Widow then?
Neither.
Why then, are you nothing, neither maid, widow, nor wife?
My lord, she may be a punk. For many of them are neither maid, widow, nor wife.
Silence that fellow! Oh, I would he had a cause to prattle for himself.
Well, my lord!
I do confess I know I was married, and I also confess I am no maid. I have known my husband, yet my husband knows not that he ever knew me.
He was drunk then, my lord! It could be no better!
For the benefit of silence, I would thou wert so too.
Well, my lord,
this is no witness for Lord Angelo.
Now I come to it, my lord. She that does accuse him of fornication in self-same manner doth accuse my husband, and charges him of a time when I suppose I'd held him in my arms with all the effects of love.
Charges she more than me?
Not that I know.
No, but you say your husband.
Aye, my lord, and that is Lord Angelo. Who thinks he ne'er knew my body, but thinks he knows Isabel's.
This is strange abuse. Let's see thy face.
My husband bids me. Now I will unmask. This is the face, thou cruel Angelo, that thou once swore'st worth a looking upon. This is the hand, the vowed contract once fast beloved to thine. And this is the body that took away the match from Isabel in the garden house in her imagined person.
Knowest thou this woman, Angela?
I do confess, my lord, I do know this woman. And 5 years since, there was some speech of marriage betwixt her and me, which was broke off, partly for that her promised proposals came not to composition, but chiefly for that her reputation was disvalued in levity. And since that time of 5 years, I have not spake with her, nor seen her, nor heard from her, upon my faith and my honour.
My lord, light comes from heaven, words come from breath. As there is sense in truth, and truth in virtue, I am affianced this man's wife.
I did but smile till
I
now.
I did but smile till now. Now, my good lord, give me the scope of justice. My patience here is touched. I do perceive these poor informal women are no more but instruments of some more mightier member that sets them on. Give me the way, my lord, that I may find the practice out.
Aye, with
my heart and punish them to your height of pleasure. You, foolish friar, and you, pernicious woman, compact with her that's gone. Thinkest thou thy oaths, though they would swear down each particular saint, were testimonies against his worth and credit that sealed in approbation? Lady Aeschylus, come, stand with my cousin, and lend him your kind pains to find this matter out, whence it is derived. There is another friar that set them on. Let him be sent for.
Would he were here, my honour. Unfortunately, we don't have him here at the moment, but the provost knows where he abides. Perhaps she may fetch him.
Go, do it instantly. And, my noble cousin, whom it concerns to hear these matters out, do you, with your accusers, as seems you fit in any punishment. I, for a while, will take my leave, but stir you not until you are well determined on these slanders.
My lord, we'll do it thoroughly. Signor Lucio, did not you say you knew that Friar Lodovic to be a dishonest person?
Gagulis non facit monacum. Honest in nothing but in his clothes, and one that spoke most villainous speeches of the Duke.
We shall entreat you to abide here until he come, and then enforce them against him. We'll find this fellow a notable friar.
Yes, any in Vienna, on my word.
Call that same Isabel here once again. I would speak with her. Pray you, my lord, give me leave to question. You'll see how I'll handle her.
No better than he, by her own account.
Forsake you.
My lady, I think she had sooner confess if you work on her privately. Perchance in public, she'll be ashamed.
I will go darkly to work with her.
That's the way, for women are light at midnight.
Come, mistress. Here's a gentlewoman denies all that you have said.
Oh, my lord, here comes the rascal I spoke of.
Ah,
here
very provost. Very good time. Speak you not to him until we call upon you. Come. Now, sir. Did you set upon these women to slander Lord Angelo? They've confessed you did.
Tis false.
How? Know you where you are?
Respect to your great place, and that the devil sometimes be honoured for his burning throne. Where is the Duke? Tis he should hear me speak.
The Duke is in us, and we shall hear you speak. Look, you speak justly.
Boldly, at least. But you poor souls. Come you to seek the lamb here of the fox? Good night to your redress. Is the Duke gone? Then is your cause gone too. The Duke's unjust, thus to retort your manifest appeal and put your trial in the mouth of he you come here to accuse.
This is the rascal! This he I spoke of!
Thou unreverend and unhallowed friar! To the rack with him! We'll towse you joint by joint.
Be not so hot. The Duke dare no more stretch this finger of mine than he dare rack his own. His subject I am not, nor here provincial. But my business has made me a looker on here in Vienna, where I have seen corruption boil and bubble till it overrun the stew. Laws for all faults, but faults so countenanced that the very law stands like a forfeits in a barber's shop, as much in mocker's mark.
This is slander to the state! Away with him to prison!
What can you vouch against him, Signor Lucia? Is this the man you did tell us?
It is he, my lord. Come here,
goodman Baldpate.
Do you remember me?
I remember you, sir, by the sound of your voice. We met at the prison in the absence of the Duke.
Ah, did we so? And do you remember what spake you of the Duke?
Most notedly, sir.
Do you so, sir? And is the Duke a fool, a fleshmonger, and a coward, as you then thought him to be?
You, sir, must change places with me ere you make that my report. You spoke so of him, sir, and much more, much worse.
Damnable fellow! Did I not pluck thee by the nose for thy speeches?
Such a fellow will not be talked with all. Away with him to prison. Where is the provost? Away with him to prison. Lay bolts enough upon him. Let him speak no more. Away with those jingles, too, and that other confederate companion.
Stay you, sir. Stay away. What resists he? Help him, Signor Lucio.
Come, sir. Show your sheep-biting names to you hang in the hour.
Well, thou art the first knave heir mate to Duke. First good you not awake, sir, the friar and you must have words anon. Lay hold on him.
This may be worse than hanging.
You, Lady Aeschylus, what you have spoken, I forgive. Therefore, stay there. We shall borrow place of him. If you please, sir. Lord Angelo, hath you word, nor wit, nor impudence that can yet do you service? If you have, rely upon it until my tale be told, and then hold no longer out.
Oh, my dread lord, I would be guiltier than my own guiltiness to think that I could be undiscerned when I perceive your grace hath with divine power looked upon my passes. Now, good my prince, no longer session hold upon my shame. Let my trial be mine own confession. Immediate sentence then, and sequent death, are all the grace I beg.
Come forward, Mariana. Say, wast thou e'er contracted to this woman?
I was, my lord.
Then go. Take her hence, and marry her immediately. Friar, do you the service? Which, completed, return him here again. Provost, go with them.
My lord, I am more amazed at his dishonor than at the strangeness of it.
Come forward, Isabel. Your duke, your friar, is now your duke. As I was then, not changing heart with habit, I am still attorney at your service. You are pardoned, Isabel. And now, be you so kind to me. Your brother's death, I know, lies heavy at your heart, and you may wonder why I concealed myself, striving to save his life, and would not rather make rash remonstrance of my power than let him so be lost. Oh, good maid, it was the swift celerity of which I did think with slower foot came on that brained my purpose. But peace be with him. That life is better life, past fearing death than he who lives to fear. Make it your comfort, so happy is your brother.
I do, my lord.
As for this newly married man returning here, whose salt imagination has assailed your well-defended honour, you must forgive for Mariana's sake. But, as he adjudged your brother, being criminal, in double violation of sacred chastity and promise breach, hereon dependent for your brother's life, the very mercy of the law cries out most audible, even from his proper tongue. An Angelo for a Claudio, a death for a death. Haste still answers haste, and leisure pays leisure. Like doth quick like, and measure still for measure. Therefore, Angelo, thy faults thus manifested, which though thou wouldst deny, denies thee vantage, we do condemn thee to the very block where Claudio stooped, and with like haste. Away with him.
My good lord, I hope you do not mock me with a husband.
It is your husband mocked you with a husband. Consenting to the safeguard of your honor, we thought your marriage fit, else imputation for that he knew you might spoil your life and ruin your good to come. His possessions, though by confiscation they are ours, we do instate and widow you with all, to buy you a better husband.
My lord, I crave no other, no better man.
Never.
Gentle, my lady.
You do but lose your labour. Now, sir, to you.
No. Isabel, remember your needs, and all my life I will live to do you service.
Against all reason do you importune her? Were she to bend her knee in defence of this wretch, her brother's ghost, his paved bed would break and drag her hence in horror.
Isabel, sweet Isabel. Please lend me your knee. Hold up your hand, say nothing, I'll speak all. For it is
disguise for Claudio's death.
Most bounteous sir, look, if it please you, on this man condemned, as if my brother lived. I partly think a due sincerity governed his deeds till he did look on me. Since it is so, let him not die. My brother had but justice in that he did the thing for which he died. For Angelo, his bad acts did not overtake his bad intent, and must be buried but as an intent that perished by the way. Acts are not subjects, intents but merely thoughts.
Merely, my lord.
Your suit's unprofitable. Therefore stand up. I have bethought me of another fault. Provost, how came it that Claudio be executed at an unusual hour?
It was commanded so.
Had you special warrant for the deed?
No, it came by private messenger.
For which we do discharge you of your office. Hand over your keys.
I thought it was a fault, but knew it not, yet did repent after more advice, for testimony whereof, one here in the prison that should have died by private order when Claudio would have lost his head, I have reserved alive.
What's he?
His name is Barnardine.
I would thou had done so with Claudio. No, bring him hither, I would look upon him.
I am sorry one so learned.
I am sorry one so learned and so wise as you, Lord Angelo, have still appeared, should slip so grossly, both in the heat of blood and lack of tempered judgment afterward.
I am sorry, and such sorrow I procure, and so deep sticks it in my penitent heart that I do wish for death rather than mercy. It is my deserving, and I do entreat it.
This is not Barnardine, but another I have reserved alive, who should have lost his head when Claudio should have lost his, as much to Claudio as to himself.
Well, if he be like your brother, for his sake is he pardoned. And now, dear maid, for your gentle sake, give me your hand. And save will be mine. He is my brother too. But fitter time for that. By this, I see Lord Angelo perceives he's safe. I think I see a quickening in his eye. Well, Angelo, your evil quits you well. Look you, you love your wife, her worth yours. I find an apt remission in myself, but there is one I cannot pardon. You, sir, who knew me for a fool. A madman, one all of leisure, a drunkard, an ass. What, sir, have I ever deserved of you that you extol me thus?
Faith, my lord, I spoke it back according to the trick. If you will hang me for it, you may. But I had rather it would please you I might be whipped.
Whipped and hanged. Promised. Declare it around the city. If there is any maid wronged by this lewd fool, as there is one I have heard from his very own lips, he did begot with child. Let her appear, and he shall marry her. The nuptial done, let him be whipped and hanged.
Oh, I beseech your highness, do not marry me for whore. Good my lord, you said even now I made your duke. Do not recompense.
By mine honour, you shall marry her. Thy slanders, I forgive, and do hereby remit thy other forfeits. Go, take him to prison and see my pleasure herein executed.
Marrying a punk, my lord, is praising to death, whipping and hanging.
Slandering a prince deserves it. Claudio. Joy to you, Mariana. Love her, Angelo. I have confessed her, and I know her worth. Thanks, Lady Aeschylus, for your much goodness. There is more that's behind that is yet to congratulate. Provost, my thanks for your care and secrecy. We shall employ thee in a better place. aren't you the head of Ragazine and for Claudius? And now, Isabel, I have a matter much important to your good, which, if you're a willing ear inclined, what's mine is yours. Come to our palace, where I'll let you know what's yet behind that meets you all should know.